Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Deep Learning Revolution by Terrence J. Sejnowski, narrated by Shawn Compton. Preface. If you use voice recognition on an Android phone or Google Translate on the internet, you have communicated with neural networks trained by deep learning. In the last few years, deep learning has generated enough profit for Google to cover the costs of all its futuristic projects at Google X, including self-driving cars, Google Glass, and Google Brain. Google was one of the first internet companies to embrace deep learning. In 2013, it hired Jeffrey Hinton, the father of deep learning, and other companies are racing to catch up. The recent progress in artificial intelligence, AI, was made by reverse engineering brains. Learning algorithms for layered neural network models are inspired by the way that neurons communicate with one another and are modified by experience. Inside the network, the complexity of the world is transformed into a kaleidoscope of internal patterns of activity that are the ingredients of intelligence. The network models that I worked on in the 1980s were tiny compared with today's models, which now have millions of artificial neurons and which are dozens of layers deep. What made it possible for deep learning to make big breakthroughs on some of the most difficult problems in artificial intelligence was persistence, big data, and a lot more computer power. We're not good at imagining the impact of a new technology on the future. Who could have predicted in 1990, when the internet went commercial, what impact it would have on the music business, on the taxi business, on political campaigns, on almost all aspects of our daily lives? There was a similar failure to imagine how computers would change our lives. Thomas J. Watson, the president of IBM, is widely quoted as saying in 1943, "I think there is a world market for maybe five computers." What's hard to imagine are the uses to which a new invention will be put, and inventors are no better than anyone else at predicting what those uses will be. There's a lot of room between the utopian and doomsday scenarios that are being predicted for deep learning and AI, but even the most imaginative science fiction writers are unlikely to guess what their ultimate impact will be. The first draft of the deep learning revolution was written in a few focused weeks after hiking in the Pacific Northwest and meditating on the remarkable recent shift in the world of artificial intelligence, which had its origin many decades earlier. It is a story about a small group of researchers challenging an AI establishment that was much better funded and, at the time, the only game in town. They vastly underestimated the difficulty of the problems and relied on intuitions about intelligence that proved to be misleading. Life on Earth is filled with many mysteries, but perhaps the most challenging of these is the nature of intelligence. Nature abounds with intelligence in many forms, from humble bacterial to complex human intelligence, each adapted to its niche in nature. Artificial intelligence will also come in many forms that will take their particular places on this spectrum. As machine intelligence based on deep neural networks matures, it could provide a new conceptual framework for biological intelligence. The deep learning revolution is a guide to the past, present, and future of deep learning. Not meant to be a comprehensive history of the field, it is rather a personal view of key conceptual advances and the community of researchers who made them. Human memory is fallible and shifts with every retelling of a story, a process called reconsolidation. The stories in this book stretch over 40 years, and even though some are as vivid to me as if they occurred yesterday, I am well aware that the details have been edited by my memory's retellings over time. Part 1 provides the motivation for deep learning and the background needed to understand its origins. Part 2 explains learning algorithms in several different types of neural network architectures. And Part 3 explores the impact that deep learning is having on our lives and what impact it may have in years to come. But as the New York Yankees philosopher Yogi Berra once said, it's tough to make predictions, especially about the future. Part 1. Intelligence Reimagined. Timeline. 1956. The Dartmouth Artificial Intelligence Summer Research Project gave birth to the field of AI and motivated a generation of scientists to explore the potential for information technology to match the capabilities of humans. 1962. Frank Rosenblatt published Principles of Neurodynamics, Perceptrons, and the Theory of Brain Mechanisms, which introduced a learning algorithm for neural network models with a single layer of variable weights, the precursor of today's learning algorithms for deep neural network models. 1962. David Hubel and Torsten Wiesel publish Receptive Fields, Binocular Interaction and Functional Architecture in the Cat's Visual Cortex, which reported for the first time the response properties of single neurons recorded with a microelectrode. Deep learning networks have an architecture similar to the hierarchy of areas in the visual cortex. 1969. Marvin Minsky and Seymour Papert publish Perceptrons, which pointed out the computational limitations of a single artificial neuron and marked the beginning of a neural network winter. 1979. Jeffrey Hinton and James Anderson organized the Parallel Models of Associative Memory workshop in La Jolla, California, which brought together a new generation of neural network pioneers and led to publication of Hinton and Anderson's collected volume by the same title in 1981. 1987. The first Neural Information Processing Systems, NIPS, conference and workshop was held at the Denver Tech Center, bringing together researchers from many fields. 1. The Rise of Machine Learning. Not too long ago, it was often said that computer vision could not compete with the visual abilities of a one-year-old. That is no longer true. Computers can now recognize objects and images about as well as most adults can, and there are computerized cars on the road that drive themselves more safely than an average 16-year-old could. And rather than being told how to see or drive, computers have learned from experience, following a path that nature took millions of years ago. What is fueling these advances is gushers of data. Data are the new oil. Learning algorithms are refineries that extract information from raw data. Information can be used to create knowledge. Knowledge leads to understanding, and understanding leads to wisdom. Welcome to the brave new world of deep learning. Deep learning is a branch of machine learning that has its roots in mathematics, computer science, and neuroscience. Deep networks learn from data the way that babies learn from the world around them, starting with fresh eyes and gradually acquiring the skills needed to navigate novel environments. The origin of deep learning goes back to the birth of artificial intelligence in the 1950s, when there were two competing visions for how to create an AI. One vision was based on logic and computer programs, which dominated AI for decades. The other was based on learning directly from data, which took much longer to mature. In the 20th century, when computers were puny and data storage was expensive by today's standards, logic was an efficient way to solve problems. Skilled programmers wrote a different program for each problem, and the bigger the problem, the bigger the program. Today, computer power and big data are abundant, and solving problems using learning algorithms is faster, more accurate, and more efficient. The same learning algorithm can be used to solve many difficult problems. Its solutions are much less labor-intensive than writing a different program for every problem. Learning how to drive. The $2 million cash prize for the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency, DARPA, Grand Challenge in 2005 was won by Stanley, a self-driving car instrumented by Sebastian Thrun's group at Stanford, who taught it how to navigate across the desert in California using machine learning. The 132-mile course had narrow tunnels and sharp turns, including Beer Bottle Pass, a winding mountain road with a sheer drop-off on one side and a rock face on the other. Rather than follow the traditional AI approach by writing a computer program to anticipate every contingency, Thrun drove Stanley around the desert, and it learned for itself to predict how to steer based on sensory inputs from its vision and distance sensors. Thrun later founded Google X, a skunkworks for high-tech projects, where the technology for self-driving cars was developed further. Google's self-driving cars have since logged 3.5 million miles driving around the San Francisco Bay Area. Uber has developed a fleet of self-driving cars in Pittsburgh. Apple is moving into self-driving cars to extend the range of products that its operating systems control, hoping to repeat its successful foray into the cell phone market. Seeing a business that had not changed for 100 years transformed before their eyes, automobile manufacturers are following in their tracks. General Motors paid $1 billion for Cruise Automation, a Silicon Valley startup that is developing driverless technology, and invested an additional $600 million in 2017 in research and development. In 2017, Intel purchased Mobileye, a company that specializes in sensors and computer vision for self-driving cars, for $15.3 billion. The stakes are high in the multi-trillion dollar transportation sector of the economy. Self-driving cars will soon disrupt the livelihoods of millions of truck and taxi drivers. Eventually, there will be no need to own a car in a city when a self-driving car can show up in a minute and take you safely to your destination without your having to park it. The average car today is only used 4% of the time, which means it needs to be parked somewhere 96% of the time. But because self-driving cars can be serviced and parked outside cities, vast stretches of city land now covered with parking lots can be repurposed for more productive uses. Urban planners are already thinking ahead to the day when parking lots become parkland. Parking lanes along streets can become real bike lanes. Many other car-related businesses will be affected, including auto insurance agencies and body shops. No more speeding or parking tickets. There will be fewer deaths from drunk drivers and from drivers falling asleep at the wheel. Time wasted commuting to work will be freed for other purposes. According to the U.S. Census Bureau in 2014, 139 million Americans spent an average of 52 minutes commuting to and from work each workday. That amounts to 29.6 billion hours per year, or an astounding 3.4 million years of human lives that could have been put to better use. Highway capacity will be increased by a factor of 4 by caravanning. And once developed and widely used, self-driving cars that can drive themselves home without a steering wheel will put an end to Grand Theft Auto. Although there are many regulatory and legal obstacles in the way, when self-driving cars finally become ubiquitous, we will indeed be living in a brave new world. Trucks will be the first to become autonomous, probably in 10 years, taxis in 15 years, and passenger cars in 15 to 25 years from start to finish. The iconic position that cars have in our society will change in ways that we cannot imagine, and a new car ecology will emerge. Just as the introduction of the automobile more than 100 years ago created many new industries and jobs, there is already a fast-growing ecosystem being created around self-driving cars. Waymo, the self-driving spin-off from Google, has invested $1 billion over 8 years and has constructed a secretive testing facility in California's Central Valley with a 91-acre fake town, including fake bicycle riders and fake auto breakdowns. The goal is to broaden the training data to include special and unusual circumstances, called edge cases. Rare driving events that occur on highways often lead to accidents. The difference with self-driving cars is that when one car experiences a rare event, the learning experience will propagate to all other self-driving cars, a form of collective intelligence. Many similar test facilities are being constructed by other self-driving car companies. These create new jobs that did not exist before, and new supply chains for the sensors and lasers that are needed to guide the cars. Self-driving cars are just the most visible manifestation of a major shift in an economy being driven by information technology, IT. Information flows through the internet like water through city pipes. Information accumulates in massive data centers run by Google, Amazon, Microsoft, and other IT companies that require so much electrical power that they need to be located near hydroelectric plants, and streaming information generates so much heat that it needs rivers to supply the coolant. In 2013, data centers in the United States consumed 10 million megawatts, equivalent to the power generated by 34 large power plants. But what is now making an even bigger impact on the economy is how this information is used. Extracted from raw data, the information is being turned into knowledge about people and things, what we do, what we want, and who we are. And more, computer-driven devices are using this knowledge to communicate with us through the spoken word. Unlike the passive knowledge in books that is externalized outside brains, knowledge in the cloud is an external intelligence that is becoming an active part of everyone's lives. Learning how to translate. Deep learning is used at Google today in more than 100 services, from Street View to Inbox Smart Reply and Voice Search. Several years ago, engineers at Google realized that they had to scale up these compute-intensive applications to cloud levels. Setting out to design a special-purpose chip for deep learning, they cleverly designed the board to fit into a hard disk drive slot in their data center racks. Google's Tensor Processing Unit, TPU, is now deployed on servers around the world, delivering an order-of-magnitude improvement in performance for deep learning applications. An example of how quickly deep learning can change the landscape is the impact it has had on language translation, a holy grail for artificial intelligence since it depends on the ability to understand a sentence. The recently unveiled new version of Google Translate, based on deep learning, represents a quantum leap improvement in the quality of translation between natural languages. Almost overnight, language translation went from a fragmented hit-and-miss jumble of phrases to seamless sentences. Previous computer methods searched for combinations of words that could be translated together, but deep learning looks for dependencies across whole sentences. Alerted about the sudden improvement of Google Translate, on November 18, 2016, Yun Rekimoto at the University of Tokyo tested the new system by having it translate the opening of Ernest Hemingway's The Snows of Kilimanjaro into Japanese and then back into English, with the following result. Guess which one is the original Hemingway? 1. Kilimanjaro is a snow-covered mountain 19,710 feet high and is said to be the highest mountain in Africa. Its western summit is called the Masai Ngazi Ngai, the House of God. Close to the western summit, there is the dried and frozen carcass of a leopard. No one has explained what the leopard was seeking at that altitude. 2. Kilimanjaro is a mountain of 19,710 feet, covered with snow, and is said to be the highest mountain in Africa. The summit of the west is called Ngazi Ngai, in Masai, the House of God. Near the top of the west, there is a dry and frozen dead body of a leopard. No one has ever explained what leopard wanted at that altitude. Hemingway is number one. The next step will be to train larger deep learning networks on paragraphs to improve continuity across sentences. Words have long cultural histories. Vladimir Nabokov, the Russian writer and English language novelist who wrote Lolita, came to the conclusion that it was impossible to translate poetry between languages. His literal translation of Alexander Pushkin's Eugene Onegin into English, annotated with explanatory footnotes on the cultural background of the verses, made his point. Perhaps Google Translate will be able to translate Shakespeare someday by integrating across all of his poetry. Learning how to listen. Another holy grail of artificial intelligence is speech recognition. Until recently, speaker-independent speech recognition by computers was limited to narrow domains, such as airline reservations. Today, it is unlimited. A summer research project at Microsoft Research by an intern from the University of Toronto in 2012 dramatically improved the performance of Microsoft's speech recognition system. In 2016, a team at Microsoft announced that its deep learning network with 120 layers had achieved human-level performance on a benchmark test for multi-speaker speech recognition. The consequences of this breakthrough will ripple through society over the next few years, as computer keyboards are replaced by natural language interfaces. This is already happening with digital assistants as Amazon's Alexa, Apple's Siri, and Microsoft's Cortana leapfrog one another into homes everywhere. Just as typewriters became obsolete with the widespread use of personal computers, so computer keyboards will someday become museum pieces. When speech recognition is combined with language translation, it will become possible to communicate across cultures in real time. Star Trek's Universal Translator is within our reach. Why did it take so long for speech recognition and language translation by computers to reach human levels of performance? Is it just a coincidence that these and other cognitive capabilities of computers are reaching a threshold at the same time? All these breakthroughs are being driven by big data. Learning how to diagnose. Skin deep. Service industries and professions will also be transformed as machine learning matures and is applied to many other problems where big data is available. Medical diagnosis based on the records of millions of patients will become more accurate. A recent study applied deep learning to 130,000 dermatological images for more than 2,000 different diseases, a medical database 10 times larger than used previously. The study's network was trained to diagnose each disease from a test set of new images it had not seen before. Its diagnostic performance on the new images was comparable to, and in some cases better than, that of 21 expert dermatologists. It will soon be possible for anyone with a smartphone to take a photo of a suspicious skin lesion and have it diagnosed instantly, a process that now requires a visit to a doctor's office, a long wait for the lesion to be screened by an expert, and payment of a substantial bill. This will greatly expand the scope and quality of dermatological care. If individuals can quickly get an expert assessment, they will see their doctor's office at an early stage of a skin disease, when it is easier to treat. All doctors will become better at diagnosing rare skin diseases with the help of deep learning. Deep cancer. The detection of metastatic breast cancer in images of lymph node biopsies on slides is done by experts who make mistakes, mistakes that have deadly consequences. This is a pattern recognition problem for which deep learning should excel. And indeed, a deep learning network trained on a large data set of slides for which ground truth was known reached an accuracy of 0.925. Good, but not as good as experts who achieved 0.966 on the same test set. However, when the predictions of deep learning were combined with the human expert, the result was an almost perfect 0.995. They do better together than either alone because deep learning networks and human experts have different ways of looking at the same data. Many more lives can be saved. This points toward a future in which man and machine work together as partners rather than competitors. Deep sleep. If you have a serious sleep problem, which 70% of us will have sometime during our lifetimes, after waiting months to see your doctor, unless your problem is urgent, you will be directed to a sleep clinic, where you will be observed overnight attached to dozens of electrodes to record your electroencephalogram, EEG, and muscle activity while you sleep. In the course of each night, you will enter into slow-wave sleep and, periodically, into rapid eye movement, REM sleep, during which you will dream, but insomnia, sleep apnea, restless leg syndrome, and many other sleep disorders can disrupt this pattern. If you had trouble sleeping at home, sleeping in a strange bed connected by wires to ominous medical equipment can be a real challenge. A sleep expert will look over your EEG recordings and mark the sleep stages in blocks of 30 seconds, which takes several hours to score each 8 hours of sleep. You will eventually get back a report on abnormalities in your sleep pattern and a bill for $2,000. The sleep expert will have been trained to look for telltale features that characterize the different sleep stages, based on a system devised in 1968 by Alan Rechtstoffen and Anthony Kales. But because the features are often ambiguous and inconsistent, experts agree only 75% of the time on how to interpret them. In contrast, Philip Lowe, a former graduate student in my lab, used unsupervised machine learning to automatically detect sleep stages with a time resolution of 3 seconds and a concordance with human experts of 87% in less than a minute of computer time. Moreover, this required recording from only a single location on the head rather than many contacts and a bundle of wires that take a long time to put on and take off. In 2007, we launched a startup company, NeuroVigil, to bring this technology to sleep clinics, but they showed little interest in disrupting their cash flow from human scoring. Indeed, with an insurance code to bill patients, they had no incentive to adopt a cheaper procedure. NeuroVigil found another market in large drug companies that run clinical trials and need to test the effects of their drugs on sleep patterns, and it is now entering the market for long-term care facilities, where elderly often have progressive sleep problems. The sleep clinic model is flawed because health problems can't be reliably diagnosed based on such restricted circumstances. Everyone has a different baseline, and departures from that baseline are the most informative. NeuroVigil already has a compact device, the iBrain, which can record your EEG at home, transmit the data to the internet, and analyze the data longitudinally for trends and anomalies. This will allow doctors to detect health problems early, when it is easier to treat them and to stop the development of chronic illnesses. There are other diseases whose treatment would benefit from continuous monitoring, such as type 1 diabetes, for which the level of sugar in the blood could be monitored and regulated by delivery of insulin. Access to cheap sensors that can record data continuously is having a major impact on diagnosis and treatment of other chronic diseases. There are several lessons to be learned from the NeuroVigil experience. Although having better and cheaper technology does not translate easily into a marketable new product or service, even a far superior one, when an incumbent is entrenched in the market, there are secondary markets where the new technology can have a more immediate impact and buy time to improve and better compete. This is how the technologies of solar energy and of many other new industries entered the market. In the long run, sleep monitoring and new technologies with demonstrated advantages will reach patients at home and eventually be integrated into medical practice. Learning how to make money. More than 75% of trading on the New York Stock Exchange is automated, fueled by high-frequency trades that move into and out of positions in fractions of a second. When you don't have to pay for each transaction, even small advantages can be parlayed into big profits. Algorithmic trading on a longer time scale takes into account longer-term trends based on big data. Deep learning is getting better and better at making both more money and higher profits. The problem with predicting the financial markets is that the data are noisy and conditions are not stationary. Psychology can change overnight after an election or an international conflict. This means that an algorithm that predicts stock values today may not work tomorrow. In practice, hundreds of algorithms are used and the best ones are continually combined to optimize returns. Back in the 1980s, when I was consulting for Morgan Stanley on neural network models of stock trading, I met David Shaw, a computer scientist who specialized in designing parallel computers. On leave of absence from Columbia University, Shaw was working as a quantitative analyst, or quant, in the early days of automated trading. He would go on to start his own investment management firm on Wall Street, the D.E. Shaw Group, and he is now a multi-billionaire. The D.E. Shaw Group has been highly successful, but not as successful as another hedge fund, Renaissance Technologies, which was founded by James Simons, a distinguished mathematician and former chair of the mathematics department at Stony Brook University. Simons made $1.6 billion in 2016 alone. And this wasn't even his best year. Called the best physics and mathematics department in the world, Renaissance avoids hiring anyone with even the slightest whiff of Wall Street bona fides. No longer involved in the daily operation of D.E. Shaw, David Shaw is now engrossed in D.E. Shaw Research, which has built a special-purpose parallel computer called Anton that performs protein folding much faster than any other computer on the planet. Simons has retired from overseeing Renaissance and has started a foundation that funds research on autism and other programs in the physical and biological sciences. Through the Simons Institute for the Theory of Computing at UC Berkeley, the Simons Center for the Social Brain at MIT, and the Flatiron Institute in New York, Shaw's philanthropy has had a major impact on advancing computational methods for data analysis, modeling, and simulation. Financial services more broadly are undergoing a transformation under the banner of financial technology, or fintech, as it has come to be called. Information technology, such as blockchain, which is a secure internet ledger that replaces financial middlemen in transactions, is being tested on a small scale but could soon disrupt multi-trillion dollar financial markets. Machine learning is being used to improve credit evaluation on loans, to accurately deliver business and financial information, to pick up signals on social media that predict market trends, and to provide biometric security for financial transactions. Whoever has the most data wins, and the world is awash with financial data. Learning the law. Deep learning is just beginning to affect the legal profession. Much of the routine work of associates in law firms who charge hundreds of dollars an hour will be automated, especially in large, high-value commercial offices. In particular, technology-assisted review, or discovery, will be taken over by artificial intelligence, which can sort through thousands of documents for legal evidence without getting tired. Automated deep learning systems will also help law firms comply with the increasing complexity of governmental regulations. They will make legal advice available for the average person who cannot now afford a lawyer. Not only will legal work be cheaper, it will be much faster, a factor that is often more important than its expense. The world of law is well on its way to becoming legally deep. Learning how to play poker. Heads Up No Limit Texas Hold'em is one of the most popular versions of poker, commonly played in casinos, and the No Limit betting form is played at the main event of the World Series of Poker. Poker is challenging because, unlike chess, where both players have access to the same information, poker players have imperfect information, and at the highest levels of play, skills in bluffing and deception are as important as the cards that are dealt. The mathematician John von Neumann, who founded mathematical game theory and pioneered digital computers, was particularly fascinated. As he put it, real life consists of bluffing, of little tactics of deception, of asking yourself, what is the other man going to think I mean to do? And that is what games are about in my theory. Poker is a game that reflects parts of human intelligence that were refined by evolution. A deep learning network called DeepStack played 44,852 games against 33 professional poker players. To the shock of poker experts, it beat the best of the poker players by a sizable margin, one standard deviation, but it beat the 33 players overall by 4 standard deviations, an immense margin. If this achievement is replicated in other areas where human judgment based on imperfect information is paramount, such as politics and international relations, the consequences could be far-reaching. Learning how to play Go. In March 2016, Lee Sedol, the Korean Go 18-time world champion, played and lost a 5-game match against DeepMind's AlphaGo, a Go-playing program that used deep learning networks to evaluate board positions and possible moves. Go is to chess in difficulty, as chess is to checkers. If chess is a battle, Go is a war. A 19x19 Go board is much larger than an 8x8 chess board, which makes it possible to have several battles raging in different parts of the board. There are long-range interactions between battles that are difficult to judge, even by experts. The total number of legal board positions for Go is 10 to the 170th power, far more than the number of atoms in the universe. In addition to several deep learning networks to evaluate the board and choose the best move, AlphaGo had a completely different learning system, one used to solve the temporal credit assignment problem. Which of the many moves were responsible for a win? and which were responsible for a loss. The basal ganglia of the brain, which receive projections from the entire cerebral cortex and project back to it, solve this problem with a temporal difference algorithm and reinforcement learning. AlphaGo used the same learning algorithm that the basal ganglia evolved to evaluate sequences of actions to maximize future rewards, a process that will be explained in Chapter 10. AlphaGo learned by playing itself many, many times. The Go match that pitted AlphaGo against Lee Sedol had a large following in Asia, where Go champions are national figures and treated like rock stars. AlphaGo had earlier defeated a European Go champion, but the level of play was considerably below the highest levels of play in Asia, and Lee Sedol was not expecting a strong match. Even DeepMind, the company that had developed AlphaGo, did not know how strong their deep learning program was. Since its last match, AlphaGo had played millions of games with several versions of itself, and there was no way to benchmark how good it was. It came as a shock to many when AlphaGo won the first 3 of 5 games, exhibiting an unexpectedly high level of play. This was riveting viewing in South Korea, where all the major television stations had a running commentary on the games. Some of the moves made by AlphaGo were revolutionary. On the 38th move in the match's second game, AlphaGo made a brilliantly creative play that surprised Lee Sedol, who took nearly 10 minutes to respond. AlphaGo lost the fourth game, a face-saving win for humans, and ended the match by winning 4-1. I stayed up into the wee hours of those March nights in San Diego and was mesmerized by the games. They reminded me of the time I sat glued to the TV in Cleveland on June 2, 1966, at 1 a.m., as the Surveyor robotic spacecraft landed on the moon and beamed back the first photo of a moonscape. I witnessed these historic moments in real time. AlphaGo far exceeded what I and many others thought was possible. On January 4, 2017, a Go player on an Internet Go server called Master was unmasked as AlphaGo 2.0 after winning 60 out of 60 games against some of the world's best players, including the world's reigning Go champion, the 19-year-old prodigy Kaje of China. It revealed a new style of play that went against the strategic wisdom of the ages. On May 27, 2017, Kaje lost 3 games to AlphaGo at the Future of Go Summit in Wuxian, China. These were some of the best Go games ever played, and hundreds of millions of Chinese followed the match. Last year, I think the way AlphaGo played was pretty close to human beings, but today I think he plays like the god of Go, Kaje concluded. After the first game, which he lost by a razor-thin margin of 0.5 point, Kaje said that he was very close to winning the match in the middle of the game, and that he was so excited, I could feel my heart thumping. Maybe because I was too excited, I made some stupid moves. Maybe that's the weakest part of human beings. What Kaje experienced was an emotional overload, but a less elevated level of emotions is needed to reach peak performance. Indeed, stage actors know that if they don't have butterflies in their stomachs before their performances, they won't be in good form. Their performances follow an inverted U-shaped curve, with their best ones in an optimal state between low and high levels of arousal. Athletes call this being in the zone. AlphaGo also defeated a team of 5 top players on May 26, 2017. These players have analyzed the moves made by AlphaGo and are already changing their strategies. In a new version of Ping Pong Diplomacy, the match was hosted by the Chinese government. China is making a large investment in machine learning, and a major goal of their brain initiative is to mine the brain for new algorithms. The next chapter in this Go saga is even more remarkable, if that is possible. AlphaGo was jump-started by supervised learning from 160,000 human Go games before playing itself. Some thought this was cheating. An autonomous AI program should be able to learn how to play Go without human knowledge. In October 2017, a new version called AlphaGo Zero was revealed that learned to play Go starting with only the rules of the game, and trounced AlphaGo Master, the version that beat KJ, winning 100 games to none. Moreover, AlphaGo Zero learned 100 times faster and with 10 times less compute power than AlphaGo Master. By completely ignoring human knowledge, AlphaGo Zero became superhuman. There is no known limit to how much better AlphaGo might become as machine learning algorithms continue to improve. AlphaGo Zero had dispensed with human play, but there was still a lot of Go knowledge handcrafted into the features that the program used to represent the board. Maybe AlphaGo Zero could improve still further without any Go knowledge. Just as Coca-Cola Zero stripped all the calories from Coca-Cola, all domain knowledge of Go was stripped from Alpha Zero. As a result, Alpha Zero was able to learn even faster and decisively beat AlphaGo Zero. To make the point that less is more even more dramatically, Alpha Zero, without changing a single learning parameter, learned how to play chess at superhuman levels, making alien moves that no human had ever made before. Alpha Zero did not lose a single game to Stockfish, the top chess program already playing at superhuman levels. In one game, Alpha Zero made a bold bishop sacrifice, sometimes used to gain positional advantage, followed by a queen sacrifice, which seemed like a colossal blunder until it led to a checkmate many moves later that neither Stockfish nor humans saw coming. The aliens have landed, and the Earth will never be the same again. AlphaGo's developer, DeepMind, was co-founded in 2010 by neuroscientist Demis Hassabis, who had been a postdoctoral fellow at University College London's Gatsby Computational Neuroscience Unit, directed by Peter Dayan, a former postdoctoral fellow in my lab and winner of the prestigious Brain Prize in 2017, along with Raymond Dolan and Wolfram Schultz for their research on reward learning. DeepMind was acquired by Google for $600 million in 2014. The company employs more than 400 engineers and neuroscientists in a culture that is a blend between academia and startups. These synergies between neuroscience and AI run deep and are quickening. Learning how to become more intelligent. Is AlphaGo intelligent? There has been more written about intelligence than any other topic in psychology except consciousness, both of which are difficult to define. Psychologists since the 1930s distinguished between fluid intelligence, which uses reasoning and pattern recognition in new situations to solve new problems without depending on previous knowledge, and crystallized intelligence, which depends on previous knowledge and is what the standard IQ tests measure. Fluid intelligence follows a developmental trajectory, reaching a peak in early adulthood and decreasing with age, whereas crystallized intelligence increases slowly and asymptotically as you age until fairly late in life. AlphaGo displays both crystallized and fluid intelligence in a rather narrow domain, but within this domain, it has demonstrated surprising creativity. Professional expertise is also based on learning in narrow domains. We are all professionals in the domain of language and practice it every day. The reinforcement learning algorithm used by AlphaGo can be applied to many problems. This form of learning depends only on the reward given to the winner at the end of a sequence of moves, which paradoxically can improve decisions made much earlier. When coupled with many powerful deep learning networks, this leads to many domain-dependent bits of intelligence. And indeed, cases have been made for different domain-dependent kinds of intelligence: social, emotional, mechanical, and constructive, for example. The G factor that intelligence tests claim to measure is correlated with these different kinds. There are reasons to be cautious about interpreting IQ tests. The average IQ has been going up all over the world by 3 points per decade since it was first studied in the 1930s. A trend called the Flynn effect. There are many possible explanations for the Flynn effect, such as better nutrition, better health care, and other environmental factors. This is quite plausible because the environment affects gene regulation, which in turn affects brain connectivity, leading to changes in behavior. As humans increasingly are living in artificially created environments, brains are being molded in ways that nature never intended. Could it be that humans have been getting smarter over a much longer period of time? For how long will the increase in IQ continue? The incidence of people playing computers in chess, backgammon, and now Go has been steadily increasing since the advent of computer programs that play at championship levels, and so has the machine-augmented intelligence of the human players. Deep learning will boost the intelligence not just of scientific investigators, but of workers in all professions. Scientific instruments are generating data at a prodigious rate. Elementary particle collisions at the Large Hadron Collider, LHC, in Geneva generate 25 petabytes of data each year. The Large Synoptic Sky Telescope, LSST, will generate 6 petabytes of data each year. Machine learning is being used to analyze the huge physics and astronomy datasets that are too big for humans to search by traditional methods. For example, deep lensing is a neural network that recognizes images of distant galaxies that have been distorted by light bending by gravitational lenses around another galaxy along the line of sight. This allows many new distant galaxies to be automatically discovered. There are many other needle-in-a-haystack problems in physics and astronomy for which deep learning vastly amplifies traditional approaches to data analysis. The shifting job market. Introduced by banks in the late 1960s to dispense cash to account holders 24/7, a much-welcomed convenience for those in need of cash before or after normal banking hours, automated teller machines, ATMs, have since acquired the ability to read handwritten checks. And though they reduced routine work for bank tellers, there are more bank tellers than before providing customers with personalized services such as mortgage and investment advice, and new ATM repair jobs. Just as the steam engine displaced manual laborers, on the one hand, but gave rise to new jobs for skilled workers who could build and maintain steam engines and drive steam locomotives on the other. So, too, Amazon's online marketing has displaced many workers from local brick-and-mortar retail stores, but has also created 380,000 new jobs for workers in the distribution and delivery of the goods sold by it and the many businesses under its umbrella. And as jobs that now require human cognitive skills are taken over by automated AI systems, there will be new jobs for those who can create and maintain these systems. Job turnover is nothing new. Farm workers in the 19th century were displaced by machines, and new jobs were created at city factories made possible by machines, all of which required an educational system to train workers in new skills. The difference is that today the new jobs being opened up by artificial intelligence will require new, different, and ever-changing skills, in addition to traditional cognitive skills. So we will need to learn throughout our lifetimes. For this to happen, we will need a new educational system that is based at the home rather than the school. Fortunately, just as the need for finding new jobs has become acute, the Internet has made available free, massive open online courses, MOOCs, to acquire new knowledge and skills. Though still in their infancy, MOOCs are evolving rapidly in the education ecosystem and hold great promise for delivering quality instruction to a wider range of people than ever before. When coupled with the next generation of digital assistants, MOOCs could be transformational. Barbara Oakley and I developed a popular MOOC called Learning How to Learn that teaches you how to become a better learner, and a follow-up MOOC called Mind Shift that teaches you how to reinvent yourself and change your lifestyle. Both MOOCs will be described in Chapter 12. As you interact with the Internet, you are generating big data about yourself that is machine-readable. You are being targeted by ads generated from the digital breadcrumbs you have left behind on the Internet. The information you reveal on Facebook and other social media sites can be used to create a digital assistant that knows you better than almost anyone else in the world and will not forget anything, becoming, in effect, your virtual doppelganger. By pressing both internet tracking and deep learning into service, the educational opportunities for the children of today's children will be better than the best available today to wealthy families. These grandchildren will have their own digital tutors who will accompany them throughout the trajectory of their education. Not only will education become more individualized, it will become more precise. There are already a wide range of educational experiments underway throughout the world at programs like the Khan Academy and funded by the Gates, Chan Zuckerberg, and other philanthropic foundations that are testing software to make it possible for all children to progress at their own pace throughout their formal education and to adapt to the specific needs of each child. The widespread availability of digital tutors will free teachers from the repetitive parts of teaching, like grading, and allow them to do what humans do best: emotional support for struggling students and intellectual inspiration for gifted students. Educational technology, EdTech, is moving rapidly ahead, and the transition to precision education could be quite fast compared to self-driving cars, because the obstacles it must overcome are much less daunting, the demand is much greater, and education in the U.S. is a trillion-dollar market. One major concern will be who has access to the internal files of the digital assistants and digital tutors. Is artificial intelligence an existential threat? When AlphaGo convincingly beat Lee Sedol at Go in 2016, it fueled a reaction that had been building over the last several years concerning the dangers that artificial intelligence might present to humans. Computer scientists signed pledges not to use AI for military purposes. Stephen Hawking and Bill Gates made public statements warning of the existential threat posed by AI. Elon Musk and other Silicon Valley entrepreneurs set up a new company, OpenAI, with a $1 billion nest egg and hired Ilya Sutskever, one of Jeffrey Hinton's former students, to be its first director. Although OpenAI's stated goal was to ensure that future AI discoveries would be publicly available for all to use, it had another implicit and more important goal: to prevent private companies from doing evil. For, with AlphaGo's victory over World Go champion Sedol, a tipping point had been reached. Almost overnight, artificial intelligence had gone from being judged a failure to being perceived as an existential threat. This is not the first time an emergent technology has seemed to pose an existential threat. The invention, development, and stockpiling of nuclear weapons threatened to blow up the world. But somehow we have managed to keep that from happening, at least until now. When recombinant DNA technology first appeared, there was fear that deadly engineered organisms would be set loose to cause untold suffering and death across the globe. Genetic engineering is now a mature technology, and so far we have managed to survive its creations. The recent advances in machine learning pose a relatively modest...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.